Okay, let's get sustainable. Here in sustainable Hawaii, we have Travis Wittmeye with us. He's B&G Innovations. We're going to talk about sustainable living lifestyle, the green life. You may not know it, but the screen behind me is actually green. We live in green here at ThinkTech. You can't tell. You can come down to the studio sometime, sit in our gallery. There are people in the gallery right now who can see that it's all green. The reality is green. Maybe that's what we should call the show, Travis.
Green, all green?
It's all green. It's all about green.
Well, interestingly enough, B plus G, blue and green.
Oh, why B plus G?
Blue and green. So I guess it would be the symbolic nature of the colors.
B&G Innovations is the name of the company that Travis has founded. And we're going to talk about that today. Welcome to the show, Travis.
Thanks for having me. We're jumping right in with the green. I didn't plan it that way, but...
Can't plan around here.
No.
Nobody can plan
around here. So life is what happens in between the plans you make. So we're going to live. B plus G. Well, most people don't know because it's not something that we bring out. But to us, the foundation of the premise when we were starting the company was why? Why are we involved in something? What does it matter? How do we stay involved?
First, why?
Exactly.
We're going to do why. Mm-hmm. I think why is really very important. You know, they said, you know, those kids, those curious kids, they only ask why. You want to smack them on the nose, you know. But first, what? So what is B&G?
B&G is a lifestyle brand which provides sustainable-minded products and services from concept to completion.
Okay, example of products, an example
It begs for more, doesn't it?
It does. Yeah, it got my curiosity going now.
We're comprised of five separate divisions. We have our products division, we have our imports division, we have our architectural and design build division, we also have our properties and development division, as well as our smart tech division.
My God, how do you sleep at night?
I fortunately was born without the need of much sleep.
The sweet bird of youth. So how many people do you have running these five divisions?
Running them? Oh, gosh.
Well, engaged in them.
Engaged. Well, our core is fairly small, and we have a lot of subcontractors and people that we partner with over the years. We've ballooned out, shrunk down, expanded out, and right now we're in the stage of less is more. So we keep
That's very sustainable.
Very sustainable, and that allows us to focus on our core issues, our core values, and I'm able to spend more time innovating, developing, creating, and not as much time as necessary to manage the people all of the time. You become a manager of people and less a creator when your business balloons out with so many operating tasks, you know, which is probably like the least interesting thing for a creative person to be involved in.
Right? Creativity first.
If only we didn't have to have business and accounting and all of these other great things, the business would be perfect.
Tell me about it. So are you a profit or non-profit?
Technically we'd be profit. Really what we are is,
very swell answer.
It is, and it is, when I'm asked these kind of questions, it's like, wow, that's a very formulaic approach to how things are put into order, but I never look at it as profit or not-for-profit. I look at it as community enhancements, and are we enhancing the community or are we not? Is it for our gain or for others' gain?
Why would you want to do that, enhance the community? I need to know.
Because I'm selfish.
No, you're not.
Sure, and I think we all are, and it's a matter of it makes me feel good, it makes other people feel good, and we have that intrinsic or that innate desire to want to do things for other people, and when we do, it's self-satisfying. And it's that simple.
Why don't you build steel mills or something?
Steel mills?
Yeah.
It's already been done. If I could improve upon them or had that desire, then maybe we'd look into it.
Got it. Okay. So I was going to ask you for an example of a product or service. What would that be?
A product or service?
Yeah.
Well, we break everything up into either things we make that go in places or things that we do that are supporting, in essence, the things that we make that go in places. So a great example would be the architectural design would be a service. The products that were the end result of our design are the products. So answering your next question.
You're designing things.
And ultimately...
For living at home. Living better at home.
Not just home. So lifestyle encompassing things that the human beings interact with on a daily basis, from either their home, leaving their home to their place of business, and then their return back home. So I know it's fairly broad, but they're mostly tangible things that you would touch. So anywhere along the way where, hey, I can improve upon this pen in a certain way, we'd be interested in it if it fits within the focus of adding sustainability, if it promotes the vision, and again, if it piques our interest.
Are you suggesting that I might come to you with a better pen and you would talk to me?
Or you could come to us with a desire to have a better pen, or come to us with a desire to have a pen function in a certain way, and then we could talk about that.
And what's the conversation? I mean, would you say to me, Jay, we can provide this for you, or Jay, let's make a deal, or Jay, why don't you quit your job and come with us and build better pens?
I'd like it to unfold a little more organic.
How would it unfold?
In the sense of it starts with just a conversation, mm-hmm. and it's not a pressure or a sales thing where we're like, we need you to come to us with your pen and we're going to do this, absolutely. It's more along the lines of, is there a benefit? And who does it benefit? And how does it benefit? And is it feasible? And is it something that, for us, first and foremost, that we could stand behind because it serves a purpose, it's lasting, and it's interesting.
So, okay, but the point is, you would talk to me.
Of course.
I'm interesting because I may have a better pen.
Or the desire to be involved in the creation of a better pen.
Okay. Now, you spoke before about the gratification of creativity, and mm-hmm. I'm into that. Everybody here in ThinkTech is into that. We, you know, creativity is our second middle name. So, what have you created most recently?
Ooh, well, I don't think we ever stopped creating. So, the most recent creation would be our fab line. So what we've done is within our products division, we've melded our architectural design division, so the actual design. And the reason why we split these things up is because we're able to offer these services individually or group them all together. And there's the synergy of connecting all of these different products with our logistics and our imports division, along with our design, along with our fabrication, and we also have a general contracting entity, so we do the installation and the build out, and adding in the smart technology, which I think we'll get to. But
yes.
Answering your question, most recent would be the fab line. We just brought out our 2015 B&G lookbook. This is our hospitality lookbook, and we've been promoting this and introducing this to the hospitality industry. And what we wanted to do years ago was to increase our efficiencies.
In the company?
In our life.
Everyone around you?
Everyone around us. I look at it as, what are you adding? Or are you adding something first? Are you adding a benefit or are you taking away? If you're adding something, okay, how are you adding a benefit? I think if I look at this, which is why I had a hard time answering your question earlier, because I'm not looking at it in a normal black and white, but I'm thinking, how do we add value? What's the thing that adds the most significant value? Strong communities, strong nations, built upon by strong families, built upon by strong individuals. We look at what makes a strong individual. I think a lot of it has to do with the a product that is created by the surroundings of the individual and what infuses life into the individual or what has something to do with it. It'd be the quality of life. So is quality of life coming from wasting time on things that are less important or spending time on things that are more important? And that's where I draw the line between efficiencies and inefficiencies. Efficiency to me means you are able to make better use of your time. Better use of your time means that you can have time that is put in areas where there's a greater result because you're able to be more efficient. So if we take and apply that model to anything, but for us specifically with a building process, we looked at how do we create a product. And in this case, a couple of years ago, was a building design that is more efficient. More efficient means more sustainable, better for life, whether it's geopolitical, whether it's local, whether it's ecological, social, economic. So looking at how do we increase these efficiencies, we got into prefabricated and modular systems.
Are you into that? That's what you do?
Very into it.
So the unions don't like that, do they?
No, and you know, there's definitely would be, has been, and will be pushback. But I'm also looking at it from how do we provide something that doesn't take away from somewhere else? And it's always, it seems to be a give and take, but if we just take and separate the issue of how do we create efficiencies through modular productions, yes, you don't like it, but ultimately, if you're looking to lead, are you looking to appease people? Or are you looking to make a choice or a hard decision that affects a greater amount of people in a better way?
Efficiency, better community.
Better community. And so who is greatly or who is most affected by something that that benefits the greater good, the greater good? So if it's a matter of building a certain way that in turn allows for a small group to have something done that is in line with what they need versus everybody else. And I'm sure that you have many, many, many shows on the merits of whether you should or shouldn't have unions. And I don't really want to touch that one with a 10-foot pole. But
I remember a case I was involved in called pole houses. It doesn't exist anymore.
Pupukea.
Maybe there were lots of them. Vestigial houses around town mm-hmm. that are built on pole. And I thought pole houses were beautiful, mm-hmm. beautiful, and so easy to build. It was modular out of the Pacific Northwest. You know, we should have more of that. We should have it everywhere. And that leads me to my next question to you. And by the way, you can ask me questions, too. I'm going to give you plenty of time for that. this goes to the question of affordable housing, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
You've got to be involved in that. I assume you are, yeah?
I think that affordable housing, you can make an argument that's at the core of many of the social issues going on locally, nationally, even internationally, right? So. If we're talking about affordable housing, what's one thing that's going to make houses affordable? If houses are produced in a way where there's more efficiencies, which means that you're spending less time, which is less cost, you're able to pass those costs on to the end user. So ultimately, if we want to
give
talk
about benefits,
I would say first off, the time that you're cutting down, and also efficiency of scale, production ordering. So if you're able to have a larger buying power, you're able to manufacture or create in a closed or a controlled environment. You're able to operate around the clock. And this brings me to another point, which is as you are, time brings on change. Change happens. I think that that's something that if you look into, you accept that.
I agree, you're gonna battle everyone.
So if we say that change is happening, and you could either be in the front of it, you could, where are you gonna be in the curve, right? The beginning, the middle, or the following at the very end. I'm buying my first flat-screen TV now. I just got my cell phone, right? A little lag time. I think that you have a responsibility if you're promoting or if you're putting something out there. So with the fabrication, as we looked at this, and I did speak with some people, and that same thing was brought up, and it was like, well, I'm looking at affordable housing. I'm looking at the sustainable aspects of the fact that you're able to cut down the traffic going to and from a site by months on end. That's less rubber on the ground. That's less pollution in the air. That's less noise to the neighbors, et cetera. So obviously, there's this another industry. I'm not looking to take away from that industry because ultimately, according to the general growth plan, we're building at far less rates than what we need to sustain the influx of people that exist. Whether if we just said no more boats, no more planes, exponential growth within a closed system still happens. There's still going to be more people tomorrow unless there's a plague or whatnot. So if the unions can use the help, that's one. Two is that...
Two is going to be the last one for this part of the show because we have to take a break after two.
Well, let's look at the benefits of what it could add. And I'm looking at secondary industry, and I've always thought Hawaii could use more tech jobs and more industry. So I know if we have to cut it short, I'll try to keep this short. But if we could put an emphasis on a secondary industry that now promotes a more school trained and let's just say more opportunity for longer time on a job because construction jobs are short. They're short-lived in nature. You don't see very many 64-year-old framers, right? And that's just the nature of the industry. But if you were to encourage an industry where you're still providing the same type of product, and now we're talking about moving into more technical skilled labor, so running of machines, production and things like that, we have the whole benefit that comes from that. And then Hawaii could put itself on the map where now we're taking ThinkTech, or if we're taking ingenuity and creativity and putting it into a technological advancements industry locally, that supports an even greater good again.
Absolutely. He's right. Of course he's right.
Yeah, give me some of that.
All right. We want more of that. That's Travis Wittmeye, B&G Innovations here on Sustainable Hawaii. We're talking about sustainable living lifestyle, and we haven't even scratched the surface.
Nope.
Nor has he asked me any questions yet. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Donna Blanchard. I'm the host of Center Stage here on ThinkTech Hawaii. Center Stage airs every Wednesday at 2 o'clock, and of course you can check out our archives on YouTube or on ThinkTech Hawaii anytime you like. Why should you do that? Because this is an arts show that I believe is making a difference in lives. We talk with artists of various ilk. We talk with painters and writers, playwrights, novelists, poets, sculptors, dancers, you name it, directors, actors, of course. And we don't only talk about what people do, but we talk about how they do it. And my favorite part of the conversation, we talk about why they do it. And it's really common on this show to hear people say, wow, I didn't think about it that way. And it's very common to hear people afterwards who have seen the show say the same thing. And I hear all the time that people are inspired by the conversations that we have. So why don't you join us and be inspired too? That's Center Stage on Wednesdays at 2 o'clock. We'll see you Center Stage.
We're back. We're live. It's cliche time. you know, if you guys would come down and sit in the studio, you know, in the gallery there, you'd hear the, you know, intermediate discussion during the breaks. It's really very interesting. So, you know, what I get, okay, is a great idea. I'm with you. I mean, the whole way this is so important for Hawaii, not only for affordable housing, but for housing.
And new industry.
And all lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we haven't caught up. And, you know, we are living in a model that's decades behind the curve. And we have to be pioneers. We have to be innovators. We have to reinvent the way we live here in these islands. And we can, and we should, and hopefully with guys like you, we will. Very important, but not easy. Because, you know, there's the momentum factor, and there's the amnesia factor. I will explain. Momentum is we do it because we always did it this way. Mm-hmm. If next person says that to me, I'm gonna smack him. The second is the amnesia factor. Yeah, we had a good idea about sustainability, but you know, something else happened, got on the radar, and we forgot. So we marched down that trail instead of this trail, and we're always like getting distracted. That's my third point. We're getting distracted from what we agreed to do before. Yeah, we like sustainability, but you know, something else came up. We got distracted, and we forgot that we like sustainability. And the problem I'm describing in general, you can call it cliche, is, you know, it's hard to change the way people live. Mm-hmm. We must actually, but it's hard. How are you going to do that?
You know what I read last night? It's a staggering statistic. And I haven't verified it yet, but I will tell you what I read, not what is true, but I actually read it in a couple places. 4,000 people a day are dying in China as attributed to air pollution. Air pollution killing 4,000 people a day. Sustainability is not going to be this choice we come upon where we can afford the luxury of amnesia or that things were done a certain way. It's gonna be thrust upon us. And the question is, are we preparing ourselves? Are we digging in and are we making strides, or are we just going to be reacting after the fact?
This reminds me of clean transportation, which I don't know, maybe you're involved in that too. You know, we've been knocking around with electric cars, but so far there are something less than 3,000 electric cars and a population of something over 600,000 cars in the state. And it's because people always did it this way.
Well, I think a lot of that too is there's also what's fueling the ability to create the electricity for the cars, because if you're using fossil fuel to generate energy to then fuel the cars, just inadvertently is connected to the same path, the same change. So I think as you have this great idea, this dream or this vision, and so as I roll backwards from that, there's a lot of great ideas, right? But how do you actually make anything happen? So
we're here to listen. We want your advice on this matter.
I don't know if I'm one to give advice, but I have put together a plan, and it's you have a dream. A dream, whether it's inspired or if that's just who you are and you have lots of dreams, you stay up at night thinking about things, maybe you don't, but I think everyone at some point along the way has had a dream. So how do you have a dream become reality? Well, your dream in effect is a vision. So as you have your vision, in order to have your vision become a reality, you need a plan. So if you,
I hope you're writing this down, because these are words of total wisdom. Go ahead.
Go backwards from the end. Start with the end in mind, right? So if you're starting with the end in mind and go backwards from the end, the dream is, as I've always put it, if I'm speaking with anybody about this or if I'm putting it forward in my own life, is I'm about to die. I have 1 second left. I'm able to push the pause button, or somebody around me pushes the pause button, and in that last flash of second of existence, I think to myself, I did right, I did good. What was it? What did I do? Okay, go backwards from that moment, all the way back. Where are you right now? How do you line it up? A plan. So the plan is to have purpose. Purpose gives you the opportunity to have a passion for something. So now you have your dream, you have your vision, you have your plan, and as you then go backwards and you're excited about it, obviously you're gonna be passionate about it. It's very hard to fail if you're passionate about it. You might have hiccups or hit some walls or fall off and scrub your face a couple of times, but you're gonna get back up. Why? Because you have a purpose. And if your purpose is greater than yourself, meaning it's not self-absorbed, it's not for me, then again, you're gonna have all of the energy and power collectively around. So then that's where I come into partnership. So the litmus for everything that we've done creating BNG is it worthy of a legacy? And how do we define what's worthy of a legacy? It's lasting. How do you make something that's lasting? It adds value. How do you add value? Again, it contributes to something greater than yourself. So for us, BNG Innovations, a sustainable-minded company, we believe that sustainable and all aspects of sustainability, social, economic, or economically and ecologically, all factor in together. So we're always looking at it as more of a geopolitical aspect of, how I like to put it, more hands going into the cookie jar, reaching for finite resources that eventually is going to run dry. And I look at it as the world that we're handing over to our children is going to be a result of the choices we make now. Do we want to hand them a cookie jar with a finite resource, or do we want to shift into a better cookie jar where all the hands have room to move around?
Perfect. Perfect. Yeah. I guess we're done now.
Well, that's the essence of everything we do and the why. So everything else is just, does it fit within that or does it not fit within that?
Okay. I mean, are you successful so far? I mean, how long have you been around doing this?
I'm alive. I'm here. I have a family that's stuck with me through good times and bad.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, I mean, successful, again, you're not going to get a straight answer out of me, maybe what you're looking for. How do you define success?
Well, what I mean is, yes, you are. How long have you been doing it?
We have been
the
involved.
Company, I mean.
Well, the BNG brand is fairly new, although it's really just an extension of what we've been doing privately for many years, which is development and homes. And as we looked into, again, having a greater purpose, because it seemed like we were going down the street of it's becoming a job. I don't know what need is filling for the community. We can say that, well, we're providing nice housing for people at a lower cost, but it didn't seem like it was a life calling, so to speak.
So how many years?
In on Oahu, about 10 years.
Okay. And what's your training? Is it in architecture or construction or technology, or I'm guessing?
Yes. Yes, and no. When I was 5, I wanted to be a concert.
This could be a long
No, session. I'm going to make this very short. It's very easy. There's only 3 dots to connect. I wanted to be a concert pianist. When I was about 17, I started to get really into world travel and started traveling around the world surfing. I loved traveling. When I wanted to be a concert pianist, I started playing piano. I never stopped. I started surfing when I was 8. Never stopped. My father is involved in engineering, architecture.
Technique.
It's accumulation. And I remember telling my parents a long time ago, I want to be an architect or an engineer when I grow up. And I remember my mom asking me clearly at a place called Southernport Traders, what would you like to do? This looks pretty interesting. Why don't you consider putting some imports in what you do? That gives you the opportunity to travel. That's a great idea. So anyways, I ended up...
She's a nice mother.
Well, she is. And a good opportunity fell into my lap when I was 27. I was able to buy the home I lived in. So as just life throws curveballs and sometimes it gives you chocolate cake. And I had a chocolate cake moment, which is nice to have the contrast because sometimes there's a lot of curveballs. The guy we rented from had cancer, he was dying. He said, I'll tell you what, young emerging family, I'm gonna sell you the house for what I paid for it 15 years ago. What was this? 1998, 99. The housing market was just going ding. So anyways, we bought it not knowing anything about real estate. To try to speed the story up, bought the house, sold it in 30 days, made a profit. I didn't even know what profit was. It was 100 times more than any amount I've ever seen. Did the same thing a street over. That afforded me the opportunity to then pay for my school. I went to and graduate from Musicians Institute in Hollywood. That was my dream of my whole life. Attend this music academy. And I did. And I signed up for it, and I had no idea how I was going to pay for it. And I just knew that I was supposed to do it, and it was going to happen. And I got in, and I was able to test up into the last year. So I cut a couple years of school off.
What instrument?
Guitar. It was primarily a guitar.
One good bang on a finger with a hammer, mm-hmm, while you're working on a house would end that.
Yeah. Exactly. And skateboarding, I broke my hand actually going in. So I was going to take my entrance exam with a cast on. I had to do everything by ear. But I was done with school. I went on to perform and play as a musician for many years. Let's just shorten the rest of it up and say that along the way, through traveling and whatnot, I was able to add in the imports and logistics, and that's how we rounded out the B&G. So as far as how long we've been around, we invested in some real estate in Indonesia a few years ago, and there's a lot of travel going back and forth and connecting, building materials for projects we're doing here, which then added, the marketing of our own projects here, which necessitated us doing some staging. So we're thinking furnishings. We're thinking, well, we can bring in the furnishings. We're already doing that. Everything has to come here. And then wanting to be creative and have fun, we said, let's just design our furnishings. So as we started designing our furnishings that we were bringing in for our homes that we were designing, that we were contracting, that we were involved in selling, we also at the same time...
Stuff you might like yourself in your own house.
Exactly. Absolutely. Because I'm looking at, well, if it doesn't sell, at least I'll have something nice. The modular prefabrication started with walls and wall panels because those are the superstructures that we're going to go in that we could get the greatest bang for the buck, like walls. The house is almost done. So at the same time, we're designing some cutting-edge wall systems. We're designing furnishings. And what happened, there's just a train wreck. They crashed, and we combined furnishings into prefabricated modular components, and that's where we came up with the fab. So your answer to what have we done lately, we rolled out our fabs, which in essence is a prefabricated system that utilizes one of our own products or product lines with our own design. And again, looking for efficiencies, how do we take and bring a product out and have it installed so there's minimal interference? If you have a business, you don't want to be closed for 3 weeks. So if we're able to do this at our own facility, using our own lines, bring it to the site, unroll it, it's ready to go.
I'm out of breath, actually. I have to do a little deep breathing now. We're going to take a short break, deep breathe, we'll come right back, and you'll hear more from Travis Wittmeye. You'll see, there's plenty more. I have a lot of questions for him, based on that alone. We'll be right back.
Aloha, welcome to ThinkTech Hawaii. My name is Josh Green. I'm the host of a program called Healthcare in Hawaii. I'm a physician. I work in the emergency department on the Big Island. I also serve in the state senate, which, please don't hold that against me, doesn't detract from my television program. We speak about all the big healthcare issues in the state. We get together on Tuesdays from 2 o'clock till 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and we try to talk about the most important issues in healthcare. This is a terrific venue for people to learn about healthcare. There are many programs on this station. We broadcast it later, not just on the internet, but also on OC16. Thanks for joining us. Please be informed healthcare consumers.
Okay, we're back. We're live. We're here. It's a good thing we took that break. So why doesn't everybody do what you're doing, you know? I mean, what makes you so creative and so special as opposed to people who like to buy it, you know, turnkey?
Okay, so in answer to what makes me creative, I don't know. I mean... We're born.
Maybe it was the piano, or rather, the guitar.
Okay, so I'll give my parents due credit. They were extremely supportive in encouraging us to follow things that we enjoyed doing, and I enjoyed creating from a young age. I come from two parents that are both creative. They're both musicians and accomplished musicians, so that was supported in our house. I had a pretty good upbringing where I was was given a fair shake with a good education and lots of opportunities around. So, I mean, I don't know how much credit I can take for that.
It sounds like you wouldn't really be happy with anything else, that this is really the realization of a dream. You can create all you want. You can create it on your own taste, and you can create a standard, a style.
I bet if you had other people that are creative on, and I'm sure that most people are, what are we? In essence, we're artists, right? So you would never ask an artist, why do you...
Art is the best part of life.
Well, why does an artist create? You would never ask yourself that. You have no idea why. You have to. It's what you do. It's like why do you breathe in the morning? I never really thought about it. It's what you do.
Everybody's so lucky, you know? A lot of people have to go sludge through life, and they never have the chance to break.
Do they? Okay, so I sit on the side of the fence where I was given an opportunity, and so it would be very pretentious of me to say, does everybody have to? But certainly, there's a defining moment in life when there's a choice, and we're all given a choice of what we're not given is a level playing field, and I'll be the first to admit that. But the choice still exists. It's just a matter of, is it going to be easier for me or more difficult for you? But the choice still remains, do you want to, and do you want to bad enough? Because we all have our own struggles and things that we're going to overcome, because ultimately, if you're going to arrive at greatness, whatever it is, then it's going to be a product of you persevering. And it's relative to how these things affect you personally. My struggle, my wall might be higher or lower than yours.
Where's greatness for you? Are you there now?
Well, I don't think, I would hope that I actually never arrive at greatness. Because greatness is this carrot dangling close enough, but always elusive.
You keep on going.
You have to keep chasing it.
Yeah.
No artist is ever satisfied or truly
accomplished. Complacent about anything.
I think you can gain mastery within things.
Yeah.
And with mastery, then you could then start a new chapter.
Where are your points, you know, that you feel really confident about your own, you know, creative abilities? I think I got it on house design. I got it on furniture, maybe. Where else?
Well, I would say those are almost semantics. Those are just, those are the byproduct of being creative, but the creativity, I would hope, doesn't have limits, and it's really, what have I chosen to be around or involved
you
in?
You don't want them to have limits.
No, and I don't want...
You want to apply your creative abilities, your creative analysis to everything, everything.
Exactly. I look at a term that we've coined recently is solutions for the uncommon. Solutions for the uncommon, turning the world over in a better place, and I believe that things come at you in life, and it's not all arbitrary. And as things come at you, whether it's a choice because you've gone down that path, or, you know, there's serendipity or whatever, I don't even need to analyze that as much as I need to make good use of my time and the things that the tools have been given, and to keep sharpening those tools and keep looking for opportunities, whether you're looking to express yourself or create and or add.
Okay, where does technology fit in all of that? You mentioned that early on, and mm-hmm. I didn't want to let it go because, well, my own feelings about it, but where does it fit for you? Are you also, you know, shaping and advancing and designing technology?
Sure.
Or are you just consuming it for the benefit of your clientele?
Yes and yes. I've been involved. I've been asking multiple compound questions all my life.
But Travis, he's got me nailed already. He just answers every one of them in sequence. And if you're really watching carefully, you realize which one he's answering and when. This is not easy.
I have a question for you, because you love a question. And this will answer your question, and everyone else who's wondering. Commodore VIC-20. Do you know what that is?
Computers.
From when?
Oh, the 70s.
So that's how long I've been involved in technology. My father had a Commodore VIC-20, Commodore 64, Commodore 128, and then we had the Apple II Plus that came out in schools. But yeah, I've been heavily involved. I started doing my own programming when I was a little kid. And strangely, it was just like playing the piano, only with a different sequence in the keyboard. And I remember wanting to be able to have cause and effect. So there's the, I guess it was a precursor to the if this, then that, right? So it was...
This is a very important statement.
Absolutely.
We're talking about the basic if statement in computer programming. And if you don't know that, you should.
Well, it became the basis. So technology, again, my father was very, very into the newest and latest and greatest in gadgetry. As a musician, I was more aligned with electronics. I got heavily into studio recording, which led to engineering, producing, composition, arranging, scoring, and I was just always...
Music is math.
Music is math, math is music. Yeah. And they all go together, and I've never even... There's no line. This is blurred over to where it's all the same thing. And as I remember, one of the prerequisite courses for actually passing and getting through school was technology and music, right? So we media sequencing, being able to use the computer as a tool, and it just became second nature. So I obviously went down the street of, you know, building my own computers for the studio, so being able to put all that together.
Something.
Yeah, doing all of the engineering, creating my own recording studios.
You started on building anything, because if you can build a computer, you can... Let's look at your slides and have a little picture show. Let's see, what you got, what is that?
Okay, so what you see right there is our BNG wall panel. And what's interesting about the wall panel is that it's something that came out of the prefabricated wall systems I was talking about when furnishings collided. So we have our own line. Importing, makes sense to import things. Everything has to be imported, not everything, but unless you're doing coconut or, you know, fish. So we're looking at how do we add a level of sustainability to importing? Well, if we're involved and aware of the entire chain, the sourcing, so we go from raw product to end user with almost everything that we make. So we have our own ability to create the
Next photo.
That's a semi-precious stone. So we have our own line of semi-precious stones. So we oversee the production and manufacturing of this stone. We can tell you where it comes from, who does it, why. But ultimately, this one is done in Mumbai. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, we merged the raw product with our design, importing, along with the modular aspect. So right there, we see those are our stair risers. And we invented a stair component, where we take the semi-precious stone, it's applied and laminated to a piece of glass. We have a backlighting using latest in technology, EL lighting. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but we have the exclusive rights to distribute light tape here in Hawaii. And with that EL lighting, we're able to backlight it with no heat transfer. 12-volt lighting can be submerged, cut to shape, field modified, and we're able to do, able to create aesthetics without the hindrance of the functionality. So we can get to technology and how it melds functionally with aesthetics, but I think what's interesting...
Where are these photos from? Are they taken here in Hawaii or somewhere?
So some of them are artist renderings that we've created, and then we have a couple in our own showroom at 619 La Puna Puna, right across from the Infinity dealership, and we have a nice showroom, and I think it's nice. But the wall panel. I want to touch base on the fact that we had a wall panel. We're talking about constructing homes and businesses and buildings, but yet we're seeing this lit panel with semi-precious stone and steel that we actually acquired here.
Wall panel with lights?
Well, the concept was to create panels that could then go in place efficiently. So that's a modular concept. But when we mixed in, like I said, the imports, the actual stone, all this stuff came together, wall panels became something that was the first in a line of products, and this is how the BNG products division came about, was creating actual products using our own sourcing, supplying, design, and whatnot. So that right there is a story into itself, much more than just a lit piece on the wall, an art piece.
But it is lit.
It is absolutely lit, and controlled with smart technology.
Oh, wow. Which one is that?
We can do that with pretty much...
This one?
That one right there was designed to emulate the flow of magma.
And two back. That one. Mm-hmm. That's nice.
So what we have is a LED lighting panel that is connected to smart technology, and we could have a whole show on smart technology. I think we should maybe save
one
for that.
You're designing it. You're bringing people in.
We are innovating.
Take your instructions and create products that, like this one, that you have designed.
We're innovating with smart technology and hoping that we are in the forefront of this emerging technology, which I see to be shaping the lives of individuals for years to come in the way that, say, cellular phone technology.
But you have to keep on doing that. There's no rest for you, Travis.
I don't want to rest. So I have a friend, Bob, amazing man, physician, pilot. He's also a lawyer. He has a company that rolls out patents for medical inventions. He He's a rabbi, a martial artist, musician, and I met him through surfing big waves.
He's an accumulated person like you.
And I asked him, you know, I was having problems sleeping or something, and he's like, who needs sleep? We can sleep when you're dead.
Later.
That was it.
Just hold that thought.
And he hasn't slept since.
Want to look at more photos?
Sure.
Okay. Let's see if we can find one we haven't seen. Okay, well, let me get off that and ask you, whoops, I think we have something. Ignition. What is that?
Okay, really cool. Translucent concrete. Nowhere else in Hawaii, and rarely even in the United States of America, are you going to come across this product. We, in our efforts to always be involved in cutting-edge technologies, whether they're hard like this or digital, we came across the product, and there's two manufacturers in the world. We've reached out to both of them, and then again, we're given the exclusive rights to distribute this product here in Hawaii. And it's absolutely amazing. 13,000 PSI, the strength of it is greater than your standard concrete.
That's concrete?
It is concrete, and it has fiber optic strands through it that can be customized to a design. It's end lit, so you backlight it again. So where we
can
come
you
in...
Can you see things through it?
You can.
Oh.
Absolutely. You can hold it up to a light. You can hold it up in the sun.
You can design it any way you want.
Any way that you want, and you could even make it structural with steel reinforcement.
You know what this means?
Money.
Yeah. Wait, give me a picture of this. Wait. No. Picture of me. Picture of me.
So everything is relative.
There it is. Money.
Money is valued at what? Obviously, what somebody's willing to pay for it, what someone's willing to sell it for. But if we look at it as something that fitting in with the premise of being sustainable, so economically sustainable, ecologically sustainable, absolutely. The concrete's going to last endlessly. We're using an EO lighting system, so we are talking 60, 70,000 hours of life behind with the lighting. We're talking the fact that the concrete is durable, can be interior, exterior. You can tool it as stone. You can knock it down. You can drop a hammer on it. It's fine. Can fix it. So this brings us something I think is really, really, really important. Sustainability or sustainable. What does that even mean? Could ask a lot of different people and probably get different answers. But to us, we really want to narrow in on sustainable luxury lifestyle. And then we have to ask why luxury and what is lifestyle. But starting with sustainable first, if we're talking about sustainable being something that's durable and that lasts, because if we're answering the question of why, we're looking at how do we affect in a greater way in the future to come for our children. Turning the world over in a better place means that we haven't depleted all of our resources. It means that we're making sound practices that affect our environment in a positive way. And how we see affecting the environment in a positive way is being responsible for the products we use and sharing and promoting the way in which we use products. And that's what every single B&G product is this a vehicle? I just close my eyes and it's a little truck or a tarp, Jeep or whatever. And this is a little B&G Jeep driving away as the vision and it's saying sustainable. Buy sustainable, be sustainable. And it's just to illustrate the fact that our focus or our point is not to make products to sell products. Our point is to promote sustainability.
Are you exporting from Hawaii?
We would love to, and we are actually looking into doing more in the mainland. So we've reached out to a few people, and we have some products that people are interested in, and we're working with that.
That's great, because if it's creative, you know, and you have a unique position in the marketplace, that would help. But, you know, it strikes me that this is expensive, and it strikes me that, you know, you probably will do well in those big, tall Kaka'ako condo places, the ones that cost $100 million, where if the guy spends $100 million on the condo, I'm not kidding, if he spends $100 million on the condo, he's likely to spend whatever it takes to furnish the condo and make the condo unique in some way. I mean, is that part of your market? How do you feel about that?
Well, I want to answer that in two parts. One, expensive is relative. And if you're looking at, we talk about the problem, why isn't everyone creative? Why, at the break, we mentioned that. One, I think one of the great tragedies within our culture is apathy and short-term gains. And if we look at how we have basically traded off quality for short-term gains of products that are completely disposable, what we've done is we've created a path of absolute anti-sustainability. Our entire focus is to change that paradigm into concentrating our energies, providing products that are durable and sustainable. So sustainable is durable and lasting. Lasting might cost twice as much now, but if it lasts four times as long, is it more expensive? So it's relative to a shelf life and how it can be used. So I don't see these things as being more expensive if you're talking about making a smart move. So if you want to say, like, I'm going to do a short-term purchase on something I don't care about, and I don't care about the environment or the world we're handing over our children, okay, it's cheaper. But one of my phrases is, cheaper does not mean less expensive. So you will pay for it now, or you'll pay for it then.
Yeah. And well, you know, sustainability for me doesn't mean that it'll last forever. Sustainability for me means that the state will have a reputation, a place in the world, an economy, a gestalt that will make it sustainable. Make it long term, make people like it into another period of history. You know, for example, we got to get off here in a minute, but in the 30s, there was Webley Edwards doing Hawaii calls with a national radio hookup, which was unseen until then, unheard until then, in the Moana Hotel courtyard, okay? And he reached millions of people around the world. And his picture, his vision of Hawaii, is still a critical vision for people everywhere in the world about what we are, what we mean. You know, hula grass skirts, it may not be accurate. We have to sort of catch that up. But I see what you are doing as the creation of form and color and beauty that will brand us again, that will give us a worldwide reputation, and that will make us, as a community, as a state, as an economy, a new sustainability, because it takes many sustainabilities to make something that is sustained, you know, various factors. And
it takes a village to raise a child? And,
yeah. That's what I see as sustainable, you know, looking at your business and your ideas.
Well, I'd be honored if we can even contribute this much, because it means at least we're going in the right direction. Right, and as far as whether this the buildings in Kaka'ako or whatnot, the price point is we're looking at it to be able to come down, and the premise behind sustainable luxury lifestyle is answer to your second question is, yeah, we are gearing towards putting these products into the peripherals of the people that can afford it initially. And what we're hoping for, our strategic plan is not that we are exclusively branded as providing products only for the uber rich. What we're looking for is a community trickle down. So as there's a responsibility for those that can, if we're looking at where, how do you roll out products, you have to support them with R&D and you have to have additional buyers. So we talked about the bell curve earlier and people buying in at certain stages. So what we're looking at is I would equate it to when plasma screen televisions came out, and you look at who was able to buy those and how much they were. Well, eventually, you know, not so many years later, it's unheard of to have a CRT screen, right? Everyone has a flat screen TV. How did that happen? Because the upper end market provided the basis for the R&D and for the initial rollout, which then also created this branding or this imagery. It's cool. That's great.
So in the end of the day, you were actually designing this for the middle class.
Absolutely.
And you want to spread it as far as you can and give the benefits to as many people. And I appreciate that. Great discussion. I really learned a lot today. Thank you, Travis.
All right.
That's Travis Wittmeye. He remembers serial questions, which I can't say for everybody. He's B&G Innovation here on Sustainable Hawaii, Sustainable Luxury Lifestyle, but more. Thank you, Travis.
All right. Thanks for having me.